very good evening to all of you. So I'm going to be talking to you here about robotic assisted neck dissection for early node negative squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity, our preliminary experience. So we actually have performed about 13 neck dissections till date on mainly oral cancers, early lesions T1, T2. And the idea here was to explore this group of patients. I mean, all of us are familiar with Dr. DiCruz's paper, which actually gave a very strong precedent to say that every early oral cancers, it is better to go ahead and do a neck dissection. So we are all absolutely convinced about the fact that, yes, early oral cancers, we all recommend neck dissections. Now, the interesting part which we often face in our clinical practice is when these people, especially early oral cancers, are coming, I'm seeing more and more of these patients who are non-tobacco with some sharp teeth or dentures coming up. A lot of them who are well-educated in their early mid-age groups who come and ask us that you're going to remove the cancer from the mouth, you're going to give us a clear margin, you're going to do also a plastic surgery if necessary, but you're going to give me an ugly scar in the neck where there is going to be no nodes most of the time. So 80% of the times there is going to be no nodes, and 80% of the time you're going to give them a scar. So if you look at the body image concerns, more than 70% of the patients will have a body image concern. They are concerned about scars, they are concerned about cosmesis. And this is something obvious. I remember a very interesting publication in 2003 in BMJ by G.C.S. Smith. He gave a very interesting systematic review of randomized control trials on use of parachute to prevent death and severe adverse trauma against gravitational challenge. It's a very funny article. You all should read it. He finally concludes saying that there is no randomized control trial to check a parachute. You finally, it's obvious. Some of the things don't need a randomized control trial. Some of the things are simply clinically obvious. A person may not like a scar. I mean, finally, yes, we are all searching for answers in evidence, but some things are just obvious that when you sit in front of them, the patient is telling you that I don't want an ugly scar. Some of my patients, and no matter how much we are careful about their scar, there is one factor which is beyond our control. Even in the smallest of keyhole surgeries, you may end up with a keloid. This is something beyond us, and these are some of our patients of the last previous years. And no matter best amount of the thing, because they will require RT, they will if they require whatever, the scar is something beyond our control. So we started actively pursuing whether this group of patients, can we start with neck dissections actively. So we retrospectively looked at our data of about 13 patients. So we've been doing it for the last 1 year now. And most of these patients were radiologically negative, clinically negative. And in, if need be, many of them underwent an FNA if there was any kind of suspicious area to reconfirm. So in this group, again, all of them early oral cancers who came to us with T1 or T2, N0, M0 neck, we took them up. Most of these patients were taken up for a robotic assisted neck dissection. The interesting thing here was, okay, there were some things that we learned during our process of learning, which I thought we should share here, right? One was in terms of planning the retroauricular incision also, we've had a learning curve. Because a retroauricular incision is also not a straight word. What we learned was, many of the times, this simple thing of just the marking of that hairline is sometimes a cumbersome task, because most of the times, even after you have shaved them, sometimes there is no clear demarcation. Now, we've started actually asking our residents to mark the pre-op incision with the permanent marker before the surgery, so that we get a more clear-cut thing, because sometimes the hair is beyond the hairline. So we've started marking a pre-op hairline, and to achieve the best cosmesis, we feel the junction at which the earlobe is actually crossing that line is the best time where you take the curve. Need not be too acute, but a little around it, because that actually conceals the scar fully in complete ways. It's a very simple thing, but we found that to be very useful, and we take it in and around within 1 centimeter of that hairline to get the maximum concealment. Second thing was, we found that the simple landmarks, as I started learning, I remember when Dabas came initially and then we started building up these cases, the first simple thing was, this was upside down. There in TORS it was inside out, here it was upside down. I had to completely run it the reverse way from up to down. And that's where I actually started reorienting my landmarks in a different way. Some of the simple things I learned was actually how to pick up the platysma. Because the initial phases, the platysma was the one that I used to miss as to when it would come in. So then I realized that the moment I see the greater auricular nerve, the platysma will come in there, just above it. So these were simple landmarks that helped me learn that immediately these are simple landmarks that can pick up this area so that I can get a little better amount of flap elevations there. The third part was, yes, we used some devers and we've made some of our own retractors to actually give us counter traction. Now I feel that when we are doing a retroauricular approach, counter traction is very crucial. And that is where many of us struggle. So we've done our own retractors for counter traction with the suction, because we found that suction, and now we are trying to add a light adapter to it, because even with the light, it'll be even better. But another thing is, simple using of a malleable is very good. A malleable with devers can give you a beautiful counter traction to give you a very nice plane elevation, because it saves time. You can actually save a lot of time with a good counter traction. So we have a mean follow-up of about 5.5 months now. And only one among them who has come up with a distant metastasis. But loco-regional recurrence is not there. We've been very careful in choosing very selective cases initially to start with, to see whether we are confident to touch this approach. And we've got some good results. So this is a gentleman wherein early buccal mucosa cancer, we did it's a T2 lesion. He underwent a free flap reconstruction and the neck dissection was done robotically. So my plastic surgeons are working with me and doing all the anastomosis with us. The cosmesis for the patients is quite gratifying. This is another gentleman who's a software techie who was overtly concerned about a CA maxilla, early T1 lesion, which was just sitting on the alveolar region. We were able to do the partial alveolectomy there, give him a free flap and do a robotic neck dissection. Many of such cases which we feel where the people are, like this gentleman is hardly 28, for him to sit with a big scar for a clinically, radiologically N0 neck would be something of an overkill. So these are patients that we have started carefully selecting now in our journey to actually encourage them to go in for a robotic neck dissection, because I feel it's a very decent indication. And we could use more and more of our robotic skills over here to give them these results. This lady, again, a partial glossectomy. She is 29 years old. Her main concern was the neck scar. So we went ahead, did the robotic neck dissection along with the partial glossectomy, free flap reconstruction, and this is a post-RT pictures. So with IMRT, we are able to actually give a very balanced, I would say, skin sparing effect and decent cosmesis in a combined way. So again, the couple of things that we just started observing, even in the salvage setting, many of the times, the recent patient that we did in the salvage setting was a lady who had come to us with a tonsillolingual sulcus tumor, T2N0M0, treated with CTRT. There were some suspicious nodes at the time of CTRT, but they were not clinically proven. 6 to 7 months later, after CTRT, she's developed a neck node in that area. FNACK metastatic squamous cell carcinoma. We went ahead, did a robotic neck dissection because she was overtly concerned about a scar. She was in the middle age, but overtly concerned about the scar. The final HPR has now come as foreign body giant cell reactions. There were no viable tumor cells there. So they were all in the degrading stage. Many of such cases, and we are carefully selecting small, tiny cases where we are going to have the least error margins. We've had some difficulties initially. So marginal paresis was one thing that we were overtly concerned about, because our heat dissipation there was a little less controlled, because for us that area was very crucial, because we had to give good vessels to our plastic surgeon. We had to dissect that neatly and yet protect the nerve. So in principle, I think this is a good area where we can, as early robotic initiators, take up some safe cases to start with, and we've had some encouraging responses. Patients are thankful, the results are good, and overall satisfaction for the doctors and surgeons is also good.